What is up, party people? Why do I think you're party people? Because you are here and you like extreme, and so do I. You may have seen my video last week of my Decadence dance cover, and in this episode of Moving Forward, we're going to talk about what I learned and my appreciation for Nuno Bettencourt, who is just one of the best rock guitar players of all time. And one of the reasons is because he's so rhythmically funky and he's got a great right hand. A lot of people associate, you know, good right hands with that fast picking, synchronized with the left hand, stuff like Paul Gilbert, which I love too, but Nuno shows that there's definitely a lot more to right hand proficiency than just that single note scalar type of playing. So let's start off with the beginning riff, the intro. Got a great rhythm to it, makes you bob your head, which is a good quality, of course. But I find that to play it correctly, kind of have to be accurate yet loose with the right hand. And also be prepared to play those slides on an upstroke. Right, great riff. After that, the verse kicks in where he does this trade-off with the vocals, or the band does. And he's hitting that eight power chord and following it up with sixth intervals, which he uses throughout the song. And really cool technique, good way to kind of mix it up between rhythm and fill stuff. He's got a major sixth going on here, the minor, and is just staying diatonic, basically, with A there. He does that at the end of the song, too, after the solo. He just follows down those six intervals, staying diatonic to the key. Great stuff. Also does it leading up to the solo, coming out of the riff we just discussed. Here on the top two strings, but same concept. Starting on that A there, you can see it's part of that A major shape. It gets chromatic. And he also uses them, the six intervals, that is, at the end of the song, where it's more chromaticism. Great stuff. It comes out of the chromatic thing and creates a little melody with the chord progression. So, anyway, let's talk about more fills. That pentatonic fill he does throughout the song. Another great example of his rhythmic approach, and it's very syncopated. And because he's whacking those notes, it comes across really forcefully and in a good way. That stuff. He throws in a minor to major third hammer on. Another great example of Nuno's great rhythmic sensibility and syncopated stuff is within that pentatonic fill after the fast ascending picking thing on the low E string within the second verse. How he just waits and retards that fall down. Gives it a great little breath in there, little variation, and it, you know, catches the ear. Those sixes again, chromatic, fall down from the D. Back to the main riff. Cool little tapping riff there before he goes to that, revisits the pentatonic thing for the breakdown before the solo. But before I get ahead of myself, let's talk about the tapping thing in the second verse I skipped over, because that is really cool, because it's a wide interval thing. Also something that perks up the ears, but because he's mirroring the shape with each hand, it makes it a little easier to get your head and hands around. So essentially he's playing the A minor pentatonic scale. I guess that would be fifth position. Sorry. And basically, ascending through the scale, hammering on with the left hand. The trickiest part about this is coming right out of that back into that pentatonic fill. And then this cool rhythmic variation goes right along with the vocals. Cool stuff. Lots of ear candy in this song. So, really fun to listen to. It made a lot of fun to learn and play too. So, let's go on. The solo. Let's talk about his use of phrasing and note choice. Is just great in this solo, in lots of his solos. But he starts the solo out and makes the major scale sound interesting. That E major scale, he just throws some rhythm on it with his famous, I don't know what you call this technique. He mutes while he plays legato stuff. You know, a light muting over the A string, and he plays that triplet. You don't want it so heavy-handed that it squashes or, you know, deadens the notes. You don't want that. You want and then he's into 16ths, but you know, straight E major up until that point, and he uses the half step at the end to give it some flair, but he's staying diatonic. Now, let's talk about this B flat, B to C to diminished idea. Really cool songwriting here, in my opinion. I'll come back to the end of the solo, but just the rhythm underneath that sets everything up, allows the solo to really take it places. And it's just a simple power chord progression for the most part. And he starts off with this E, to a B, to a lower E, F sharp, B, then he drops down to an A, before I go there. On the F sharp, this is where he's hitting. Where he's hitting, landing on this A sharp here. And that's the major third of this F sharp, but he doesn't spell that out in the rhythm. He lets the lead do that. So if I played this F sharp bar chord, it's letting that the solo play the major third. Then the next chord is B, moves up to that B, and he plays a C. Cool counter movement idea here. He doesn't go up to a C, he drops down to an A. Power chord, again, no third. So he's letting the solo determine how your ear is hearing it, and your ear is going to hear it as minor because that's the minor third of E, or excuse me, A. There's our A minor, but then he follows that up with an A diminished. And he plays this chord you can hear on in the rhythm. A diminished chord. So, really, really cool songwriting stuff and just makes that solo pop. Let's play the rhythm under the solo and you can really hear what I mean. Okay, I'm also gonna play the stuff leading up to the solo, which I was talking about earlier, just so we can have an audio example. The sixth is interval in the main riff and then the pentatonic breakdown that moves up a whole step before the solo begins. All right. Now let's do the solo with the lead. Got a lot of cool stuff going on there. Like I said, starting off with that E major, but the rhythmic stuff, the phrasing sets it apart. Half step, he's moving from triplets into eighth notes into 16th notes. Then he's got a chord progression that has movement. Chromatic stuff followed up by the diminished. And then back to the major stuff and some cool rhythmic stuff again. And awesome wide vibrato here at the end. So just cool Nuno stuff all over the place. The end with those sixths intervals, those chromatic things, that actually proved to be one of the most challenging parts about the song, probably the most challenging part about the song for me. So let's go over that.
Dance into the decadence.
gotta do the little bam. Okay, so that part, it's harder than you think, than I thought at least, with those sixth intervals going chromatically. You figure, well, I just gotta keep the same finger shape and slide up and down the frets. But that proved a little more difficult, especially on the descending part. The trick that I stumbled across was when descending, try to relieve the pressure slightly between each half step in the descending part. Then you're not dragging your fingers across the frets and the fretboard. Oh. Another descending chromatic part there. Then he's outlining chords. G. D. E. A. And then this cool lick. That is prime Nuno right there. Just those accents where he's digging in. And keeps the hardest part about that lick is that bend that he does over and over again off that B that is sometimes to the C sharp. Sometimes maybe to the C. But it doesn't matter because it's all about the rhythm and the attitude. Then right back into the... And let me just point one other thing out before I wrap this up, because that's the end of the tune, is those chords that he plays in the chorus, right? The G to the D, E, that's it. Actually, I think it's a D sus too. But what he's doing there is playing the bass portion first and accenting it with the top of the chord, so he's not getting... the entire chord is not right. To my point earlier that I was making with gain and eliminating some of the notes and chords that might muddy up the sound. Another prime example there. And here this E, I know it may look like an E minor, but it's not. It's, the tonality there is E major. I'm just not playing that third. I'm actually muting it out, the third string, and it would be a minor third if it was open. It's not the sound. It's this. But neither are played. You're just muting that out. So, thought I'd throw that in. I think it's pretty important. Hope you guys enjoyed this episode of Moving Forward. I'm sure I'll probably do some more extreme and Nuno stuff in the future, just because it's one of my favorites. And I really enjoyed learning this tune. Hope you guys enjoyed going it over with me. Stay tuned for the next video, and see you then. Right on.